Amazing. Okay, Betty, I'm going to turn it over to you. You have the floor.
Thank you so much, and thank you for being here. So Shari and Christian, or Kristen, excuse me, you showed up for yourself tonight. And I think in stroke recovery, that's the biggest thing. When you show up for yourself each and every day, and some days it's going to be a little bit, and some days it's going to be a lot because you're going to have more energy to do that. So thank you for showing up for yourself today. And there's a statistic, 1 in 4 people live who have had a brain bleed. And it's not one in, excuse me, 1 in 4 live, which means 3 out of 4 people die who have been through what I've been through. So to understand that piece of it, it's like, why am I here? You know? And when you know, like, I believe I'm here to show, I love your name, Life After Stroke, that there is life after stroke and there is joy found even in a disabled body. And also to show, like, what is possible after a stroke? So that's why I'm here, and we'll connect on those things. I was 39 years old when I had my stroke, and it was a Saturday. It was Cinco de Mayo. I remember that because people were celebrating. You know, I live in California, so people were celebrating Cinco de Mayo, and I work downtown, so I went downtown, I went to work, and I'm working for quite a few hours, and I start getting numbness down the left side of my arm. And I'm like, okay, I have felt this before. This is something I've went to my doctor about. I've felt it before, but this day it was more intense. And that intensity was a little more alarming, where I'm like, you know, I'm gonna go to the emergency today. But of course, after I finish my work, because I was already there. And so I'm working, and then I feel numbness through the left side of my leg all the way down to my foot. And now it's like my left side is just where it feels like it's asleep. But I still continue to do what I'm doing. I do call my sister, hey, this is going on. After I'm done here, will you go with me to the emergency? And I was typing, and this little left hand of mine stopped moving. And literally, as I was typing on the keyboard, I watched my fingers do this and stop. And I was like, okay, it's time to go. And that's what I said out loud. I'm like, it is time to go. You are playing games with yourself. Like, it's time to go. So I back out and I call my sister again. I'm walking out and I do the arm test. And I'm like, I can't raise my left arm. I can't, not even how I just did. So I'm like, I can't raise it. And I walk out. And I'm like, I'll call you back. And I get out to a bench and sit down and I call my husband, and then I get off the phone with him and I call 911 myself. I call emergency myself and get an ambulance. Now, where I look back and I really see the blessing in that is that I did not lose consciousness in a facility that nobody would have been able to get to me. My work didn't know I was there. Truly, they would have had to break in, and that would have been hours later. So the fact that I was able to walk out, still talk and call, make this call. Now, what I didn't know that day or in that moment is my life was going to change dramatically. not a little bit, not dramatically. And one thing that I really struggled with in my recovery was trying to hold on to the very things that I worked really hard to achieve and build in my life. You know, as a 39-year-old woman, I was a manager of a team that I loved and enjoyed going, you know, to work. And I was a wife. I had my kids. My life was what I wanted it to be. And within those moments, I became left side hemiplegic, brain bleed. We don't know what it is. And I didn't know because, you know, they didn't tell me what exactly was going on. They did tell me I had a brain bleed, but they thought I wasn't going to make it. So they were telling my family, say your goodbyes, start making funeral arrangements, you know, those type of things. And interesting enough, in the emergency room, when I don't know if you've experienced this, but the screen comes down before you and it really feels like futuristic in a way, because I'm like, did a screen just come down out of the ceiling and a human doctor talked to me, you know? And the doctor said, you have a brain bleed. They did the stroke test. Can you raise your left arm, right arm, stick out your tongue, all these things. And he said, you do have a brain bleed. And the only thing I knew about a brain bleed was a friend of mine, her mother had a brain aneurysm and passed away. And this was a girl I worked with. We had a close relationship with. So I knew the devastation on the other side of a daughter losing their mother, you know, because I heard it from her. She's like, it was fine. We were making, you know, Thanksgiving type of meal. I was taking something over to my friend. And by the evening, my mother was gone. So that's all I know as this doctor is telling me about what perhaps is my future. And I was like, I'm not going to die. I have a little bit of a sense of humor, even in those crazy moments. So this is me. And I said, I'm not going to die. I said, if I see the white light, I'm not going. I've already made up my mind. Like, I'm staying here. So I still have work to do. I got things to do. So with that said, I'm still here. And like I said, what I didn't know is how my life was going to change. For me, my brain bleed was a cavernous malformation. It's similar to, a lot of times you'll hear about aneurysms and AVMs. We don't talk about cavernous malformations because it looks like a raspberry. It's a ball of capillaries attached to veins that leak, that will leak into the brain. I just did a little research on that, and it said 1 out of 600 people have a cavernous malformation. It can be in the brain or in the spine. Both can cause disability because obviously anything messing with your spine can, as well as the brain. Now, with that said, 1 out of 600 would have, this is you in the United Kingdom, 1 out of 600, but less, 1 in 400,000 will have symptoms. A symptom doesn't have to be a stroke. It could be dizziness. It could be headaches. It can be seizures. It can be some other things. So I'm like, wow, like those statistics, and I'm that 1 in 400,000, not only that had a symptom, but that had a stroke. So why am I here? Why did this happen? And that was something I asked very early on to myself, into the world. Why did this happen? And I so desperately wanted just my life back. And one thing I had to realize is I had to grieve the loss. There were losses there. You know, there was the loss of my job that I, excuse me, didn't get to go back to. There was this new body that I have no idea who this is. When I was in physical therapy, they wheeled the mirror, long mirror in front of me. And I just cried because I'm like, who is that? Like, I didn't even recognize myself, my body. And from there, it was about this acceptance of, okay, this did happen. What does it mean? Where do I go moving forward? Now we'll get to the fun part. The fun part is they did not do surgery when I had my stroke. They were concerned that if they were to go in, they could cause more problems for me or cause me to actually die. And the doctors didn't want to take that risk. So they were just going to watch over the bleed. They were going to watch over it. Within 10 days, I'm in a skilled nursing facility. And from there, I stay there for two months. So it was a long road. And believe me, I wanted to get home. I wanted to get home. And I did get home, by the way. But then I didn't know what was going to happen when I went home. What happened when I went home was there was a 3-year period of brain bleeds. So I continued to have brain bleeds every year. And then in 2021, finally, I stopped going to the hospital because I'm like, they're just going to tell me, yes, you did bleed more, but you know, we're not doing surgery. And one day, that one magical day, my neurosurgeon walks in and he says, is it time to get this thing out? And I'm like, yes, let's go. Like, I'm in my mind, I'm imagining that the whole, you know, surgery unit's going to come in and they're going to take me to the, you know, OR and I'm going to get my surgery right then. That didn't happen. It's COVID time. Do you know what that meant? That means I get to go on a waiting list and they do it by who needs surgery the most. And I was breathing and I was talking. So they're like, she doesn't need it just yet. We'll get to you. And, so from there, I waited 3 months for my surgery and I was the happiest person ever to go into surgery because I didn't care what the risks were. I knew what I was living and I wanted that part. I wanted to be able to start healing. It was very important for me to start healing now. I get my surgery done. It was successful. When I woke up, the first thing I did was did this. I said, okay, it's still the same. I lifted my leg on my affected side. Okay, it's weak, but it moves enough. So I was like, all right, we can do this. And what was so, it was funny to me, interesting to watch was the doctors coming in after my surgery, because I was coming out of the anesthesia, but I was like celebrating. And I was like, yeah, this is good, you know? And they're like looking like, what? This lady just came out of brain surgery. Like, what is happening? But what they didn't know is what I was going through. You know, they didn't know I was fatigued every day. I could barely get up and take a shower, barely get up and make a meal. I have a dog, and this dog, he's so sweet. He laid by me for 3 years every day, and he did not ask for anything. And I'm like, he doesn't even ask to go out or for food, you know, because he knew I was under a lot of, I don't even know what you call that, but he knew I wasn't well. So he was okay with going on the back burner and taking care of me. And after that surgery, it really opened up like, okay, this is day one. It was 3 years after my stroke, but it was day one that I get to start healing. Now, what I will tell you is during those 3 years, that can get really discouraging, very depressing, really sad. And I went through all of that. I went through a lot of grief, and I went through these stroke support groups are so important to me because they were my lifeline. Sometimes I would get on, I wouldn't say a word the whole meeting because I just needed to be around other people who understood, but I didn't have the strength to talk about it. I'm just like, I just need to be here and listen. But that was my lifeline, because when I got approved for my surgery, there was one person that he is also a stroke survivor. And I was like, you guys probably know him, so I am going to say his name. His name is Joe. Joe So Rocks. Look him up on Instagram. He will talk to anyone about a stroke. And I knew he was going to be excited for me to have surgery when my friends and my family were scared. They were terrified. They're like, wait. We remember 3 years ago, they said they didn't want to do surgery because you could die. And now you're saying you're doing surgery and you're excited about it. You know, I'm like, yes. And but it was day one for me after that. And during that 3 years, I had to go to stroke support groups. Even after that, stroke support groups, I still go to one that isn't mine. I go to one at a hospital. I continue to try to, if I wasn't happy, to lean on other people's happiness. What does that look like? What does that even mean? That meant I went to the park and would sit at the park and watch families with their, you know, kites and their, this is how you know I have a brain injury, because some of the words takes a while. What are those called? Were they up in the air and they have the little remote? Okay, you probably are with me. Yes. Yes, thank you. Excuse me. So I would watch families like fly kites and fly their drones and just be there. And they were enjoying themselves. And I remember one day coming home and there was a dad with his little girl, and they were in, we had tennis courts, and they were just playing ball in the tennis court. And he picked her up and he was just so happy to be spending time with her. And it's these simple things that I didn't feel happy or joyful in those moments, but I would lean on other people's happiness. until I could be happy again. And going to stroke support groups, going to therapy, going to not just physical, occupational, speech, but talking to someone, get as much support around you as possible, because you're in a time of healing. And when you're in a time of healing, it's good to have support around you for that. And not one person can take that on, but taking as much support as you possibly can. And sometimes I think we come from a culture of independence and do it, and you're strong and you don't need anybody. But community is so important, and being around other stroke survivors is huge to your healing. And so that kind of takes me through that. And then another thing, because I couldn't physically always work out or do something physical, so I kept trying to learn new things, even when I didn't know how I was going to work or how I was going to, what my life looked like. I was like, still find something to learn. And so what does that look like for me? It's going to look, excuse me, different for me than someone else. Now, I did a 2-year school in ministry. I worked for some of my friends because I was a recruiter prior to my stroke. So I worked for some of my friends, their small businesses. I did some recruiting. Now, these are on very small scales compared to what I did before. But that 2-year school in ministry kept me connected to people, and it kept me learning, and it kept my mind off of how horrible some of those days for me were. And from there, you know, I did that, and then I helped some of my friends. And now this new life, literally out of the ashes, started to rise up. I couldn't see that the day after my stroke. I couldn't see that a month after my stroke. I couldn't see that a year. I didn't know where I was going because I wasn't getting better. But when I did get better, because I had stayed connected, all these pieces started coming together. And Joseph Rocks, he put it so great. He said, your recovery is like a puzzle. And when you're at the hospital, you get those four corners. You know, we look through all the puzzle pieces for what? The four corners, because those are the easiest ones to find. They're the easiest ones to recognize, and they're the easiest ones to put in place. So we do that, and then you go to physical therapy and you start getting those edges. You're like, I know where these edges go. Now I have a plan to get back physically. If you're doing speech therapy, if you're doing occupational therapy, they're giving you the edges. But now, what is my life? As Kristen was saying in the beginning of this, I'm uncertain to know where I'm headed. In this time of recovery, in this time of healing, you're going to pick up puzzle pieces. Hopefully you'll take one tonight from here, but you'll take one along the way from other people and just new experiences that you have. And all of a sudden, this new life, you're like, whoa, it's starting to come together. So who was Betty prior? I was a manager. I had a team of 12. We did recruiting. It was amazing. It was fun. I loved it. I worked really hard to move up in the company. It was something I really prided myself on. That left. And then through my healing and through getting new puzzle pieces, I became a certified life coach and a speaker. And that's what makes me here with you today. It's my new life. And I'll be honest, this life right here, I like it. I do. And I tell people who I am today with disabilities, with it's all the way down. I have a brace on too. Okay, there you go. I have the brace on. Like, I didn't get to go, oh, hey, look at me. I get to run a 10, you know, a marathon 2 months after my stroke. That's not my story. It is for some people, but it's not for me. For the people who are able to kind of get back quickly, their story isn't better than the people who had to go the long journey. It doesn't make it more successful than the person who has a longer story. I have a longer story, you know, a longer recovery. But what I learned about myself through this, wow. Like, one thing I tell people is, show up for yourself and you may just be surprised at what you show yourself. So I want to be here to show you what's possible. But through your own healing journey, there's going to be those days that you surprise yourself on what you did, what you accomplished. I remember the very first day I laid in my bed. And you know, you lay in your bed like this, and I crossed my leg, but the affected side, without thinking about it. And next thing I looked down at my leg and I was like, whoa, my left leg is crossed over, but I don't remember doing it. It's those little things, that those victories, you take those with you. And if there's nobody around to celebrate, because sometimes celebration only happens right at the beginning. It's like, did you move your hand? Little bit. Did you move your arm? Yeah, a little bit. And you get these like praises for it. But a year later, 2 years later, you still can get your victories. Celebrate those for yourself. And I'm gonna leave it there.
Betty, that was amazing. Oh, I feel so uplifted. Thank you so much for sharing your story and
advice.
Oh my goodness. I was writing down as you were talking, so I hope nobody was like, why isn't she paying attention? I was writing it down, not so much attention I was paying. And I want to talk about so many points before I do, because you guys hopefully know I talk a lot. Tracy, actually, I don't know if I've met you before, or maybe you've come to a past meeting. Hi!
No, I'm new.
Hi, Tracy. Welcome. Hi. How did you hear
Thank
about
you.
Us?
I was I found Betty on Instagram and I filled out a form, and then I just suddenly started getting emails from you guys. So yeah, that's
awesome.
How.
Well, thank you. Thank you for being here today. I'm glad you got
to be here
of Betty's chat. Before we talk about it more, I think I just want to get to know you a little bit more. Tracy,
yes.
Did you have a stroke? What kind of
yes? It's a long story. I had a ischemic stroke, I think, during brain tumor surgery a year and a half ish ago. So I was left with left sided hemiparesis. So yes. I am on the long journey of recovery.
Okay, well,
that's so I could relate to a lot of what Betty was talking about.
And where are you from, Tracy?
Dallas, Texas.
Oh, okay, cool. Well, welcome to Dallas. That's awesome.
Where are you guys from?
We're based out of Toronto, Canada, actually, but we're from all across Canada and the U.S. as well. Yeah.
Okay. Cool. I'm excited to join with. I was just looking. I've been to a couple of stroke support groups, and I was just looking for, I guess, a younger population, because the ones I've been to are a lot of older people and people that are retired and, oh, we're just, you know, looking to do our everyday basic life. I just went back to work. So,
congrats.
And I have two kids. I'm a single mom. So it's a lot that I'm juggling. So I was just trying to find the map.
Wow. Well, thank you for sharing that. And I hope that we can help you find a lot of what you're looking for. So then I'll ask the wider group, Tracy, yourself included. Does anyone have any takeaways of things that resonated with them from Betty's talk? Anybody have any questions for her? Feel free to just unmute yourself and share.
Since I'm unmuted, I will go ahead and share my one main takeaway that I got was surrounding yourself with support, which I have a lot of great family support, but I need stroke people support, people that understand exactly what I'm going through. And then I'm at the stage, I think, where I'm grieving, you know. So, yeah, just looking for, I think, support in that area. And then trying to get connected to a real therapist to make my way through emotions that I'm dealing with. Because it was sudden for me. Like, I found out about the brain tumor, then opted for surgery. The doctor was like, I'm not worried about a stroke for you. And then I had a stroke. So it was surprising because I was not expecting to have a stroke during the surgery. So I went to sleep to have the brain tumor removed and woke up paralyzed on my left side. And I've been that way for the last year and a half. So just making improvements, but of course, grieving and still very shocked at the life that is very different from what I had. So my takeaways, I think, from Betty were surrounding yourself with support. And then I'm looking to get into real therapy with a therapist that's like familiar, I think, with people with disabilities to process through that.
Do you mind if I respond, Ella? Okay. So, Tracy, I did not go to therapy, normal, like regular therapy, until 4 years after my stroke. Woo-wee! Do I wish I would have done that from the beginning? Because I really thought, you think, like, Number one, you don't even know what you're going through, right? You don't know what this thing looks like. So you think, okay, I'm good. You're trying to manage it all. But I didn't go to therapy, get a therapist till 4 years after. And then my therapist this was like, be okay until I get back. No, absolutely not. I need to talk to someone else. Because here's the thing, it doesn't have to be big things, but some of these things aren't conversations to have with your family.
Right.
They are conversations because it's not that you're angry or mad at somebody.
Right.
It is about you're trying to process through emotions and having a third party, someone who is not in your family or friend loop, is so, because it just helps you get it out. And understand which, you know, like figure it all out, and then you can come back to your life better. So I definitely recommend that. I love the thought of support in any way, shape, or form. If that is church, if that is volunteering, if that is therapy, that's stroke support groups, whatever the case is, get as much around you, because one day you're going to be like, oh my goodness, I'm doing so much better. And which, when you're better, you get to do help other people through the exact same thing you went through. So great job. You're doing good. Like, I could not imagine being a mother of two, left side hemiplegic. I am a mother of two, and have, but I'm not like, they're not little. Okay. You know what I mean? So, but just what you're doing and showing up for yourself. I said this in the beginning, showing up here is showing up for yourself. And that is so big in stroke recovery. So keep doing what you're doing.
Thank you.
That was amazing. I get so emotional and in like the best way. Man, like, we're talking about going to therapy and having the support. And your buddy, you mentioned, I didn't go till 4 years after. And I know I didn't do any type of therapy till 9, almost 10 years after. And oh my gosh. And I'm still here at 16 years for me. Just to give you a bit of background about myself, Tracy. And is this ever helpful? Like, I'm sitting here, like, I'm going to journal about this later and like getting a bit teary eyed because like just general mental health support, having people around you that have been through what you're going through that are not family, just third parties. And yeah, you need all types of support. I'm so happy you're here and you're starting early. I'm so happy you're here and starting early. Seriously, everybody here. I wanted to talk about, I guess on that note, you said, Betty, I wrote it down. You said that I don't think you used these exact terms, but it wasn't until like 3 years later where you finally started feeling some type of motivation. You took action. It's like you took action first is what I got from it. You took a little bit of action and then you surprised yourself with what you're doing. You're like, oh yeah, I can do this. I hope I'm not putting words in your mouth. I'm trying to remember exactly how you said it, but it just reminded me of how I heard this thing once where we always think motivation is supposed to come first and then action follows it. Like, I have to be motivated to eat healthy, then I'll do it. I have to be motivated to go to therapy, then I'll do it. I have to be motivated to go lift weights, then I'll do it. When really, I think it actually works the other way around. I don't feel motivated all the time to go lift weights, but if I just start with something really, really small, something I know I don't need a lot of motivation for, and then I do it, and I'm like, oh my God, I just did that. Mm-hmm. Okay, now I have motivation. You take the next step. Oh my gosh, I just did that too. Now I have even more motivation. And when you talked about celebrating those little wins, Betty, even when there's not people around you, write it down. Take out your phone and take a video of yourself saying, I just did this. Now you have a video diary of all your accomplishments. Go back and watch it. That's motivation. I thought that was such an amazing part that you talked about. Thank you so much for speaking on that.
Yeah, you're welcome.
The puzzle analogy. That's what you were talking about. From Joseph Rocks. Okay. Yeah. If you guys haven't checked out Joseph Rocks, he's a rock star. He rocks. His Instagram is in the chat. I just put it Joseph Rocks. That puzzle analogy is awesome. Those little pieces of the puzzle, the corners and the edges.
Yeah.
That's almost like the little actions and then the motivation follows, right?
Yes.
A cool concept.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Does anybody else have any questions for Betty? Keeping in mind the recording is still on, I will turn it off. So if you want to ask questions off the recording too, we can definitely do that.
I will be really honest. I don't hide a lot of what I've been through because what I am today is what I was searching for. I share a lot because I needed to know. I needed to hear it. I needed to see it. So that's why I do what I do and share so much. So there's probably not a question you can ask me that I won't answer. Did you have a question, Kristen?
Yeah, so Betty, I find your story very inspirational and thank you for sharing. I wanted to ask you, you said for 3 years and you had bleeds after the first stroke, because I feel the same, like I'm waiting for the next health issue. So I had an unexpected carotid dissection, so an aneurysm, and I have stents in my neck, and I constantly have symptoms, and I'm just waiting for the next event to happen. And I just want to ask you, how did you, those years waiting for the next health event, it just... It's very hard. Like, how did you do that?
So what I will say about that piece of it, because we can make up really imaginative stories in our head, right? When we think about what bad can happen, all of a sudden we have all these things that were like, you know, what if I fall asleep and my brain bleeds and I don't wake up? What if I'm driving? What if this happens? I knew I could go wild. People are like, are you imaginative? Some people be like, no, you are imaginative, because as soon as we say what bad can happen, our imagination will run wild. So one thing that I had to do, as soon as my mind said, I'm waiting for the next bleed. No. I'm waiting for another stroke. No. Because you're not promised that, Kristen. That is not your promise. You're not promised more health problems. Because you had a health problem or two health problems, that doesn't mean that you're promised more. So be in the moment. Are you okay right now? Sometimes you have to bring it right back to that. Are you okay in this moment while we're on this call? How are you? Are you okay physically? I am safe. I am sound. I am okay. And bring yourself back to that place, because your imagination will go nuts. And what I want you to do, I don't know if you've done a vision board of what do you want? Health. I want wellness. I want friendships. I don't know if you want to go back to work, but say if you do, whatever those things are, start focusing on that. And as soon as your mind says, oh no, you're going to get sick again, this bad thing's going to happen. No, my future involves friendships and love and joy and peace and all the goodness, because I'm not promised, because I had one bad thing or two bad things happen to me, that the rest of my future is that. We love comeback stories, and you will have your own comeback story. So focus on that comeback story and work on stopping it. Because like sometimes when my mind would go there, I literally will say no. Just like I'm talking to a child or talking to my puppy, or no, we're not doing that. We aren't doing that. So let me go to my vision board and let's talk about what we are going to do, what our future does look like.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
One other thing that I wrote down when you were talking, Betty, was this, I guess, analogy that I heard, and it goes something like, if you're lost in the forest and you can't see the other side of the forest, so you panic because you don't think you can get out, you have no idea how you can make it through, that's okay. Because as long as you can see the step in front of you, all you need to focus on. Step after step after step, you will get to the other side of that forest, and then you'll turn around and be like, oh my gosh, I just did that. What a freaking accomplishment. And one day, I'm telling you guys, I'm 16 years out, but I'm still not perfect. The journey is never ending, stroke or not. Life is always a journey. You're going to get to the other side of that forest. You're going to turn around and be like, oh my gosh, I am so damn proud of myself. So just keep on walking.
Yeah, so good. Small steps create a stronger you and a brighter future. Those little small steps, those little things you're doing every single day, it's building that puzzle piece. It's building. You're like, I'm not doing anything. No, you are. You are doing those little things are going to build up into this new picture, into your new life, into the new you that you can be really proud of.
Exactly. I am going to turn off the recording now. So if anyone has any questions they'd like to ask off the recording, again, feel free to unmute yourself. So let's see.